Thanks, Kristen. Oh, look, there's a clock here. I can keep track of my time so I don't take too much of it. First of all, it's wonderful to be here with all of you, and an honor, I guess, to get to go first with such an esteemed panel, really. You know, I'm an investor, and I design and manage endowment portfolios, I guess, is the key context of how this will flow through here. But really, I came to investment from the world of social entrepreneurship, which Bill helped really identify, define, and catalyze. So, you know, there's a lot of, and Ron being a circular economy guy here, there's a lot of just circular thinking and activism, I think, that's brought us all together. And that's common in the impact investing world. So I'm going to tell you a bit about what I do and why that informs the impact investing world. At Cambridge Associates, we're a global advisory firm. We were up on the list that of the slide that Kristen put up there, where we have been around for 45 years, really got our start investing, advising U.S. endowments, colleges and foundations, and then increasingly large family offices, and more recently some pensions. It's grown to be a global firm with 9 offices around the world. We have over 1,000 clients, so I'll give you some data to frame, I guess, a market context for what investors are doing. I had the good fortune of joining Cambridge 10 years ago out of graduate school and was able to help build what we call our mission-related investing practice, which is essentially the impact investing practice at Cambridge. So to give you the data, of those 1,000 clients, give or take, we have 15%, just over 150 clients, that are engaged in some form of impact investing. So if you go back a few slides and think about that range between traditional investments and philanthropy, that space, in those bars, we have clients doing some form of very intentional active engagement around either values-aligned investing, considering ESG factors, or really trying to drive change in certain markets or ecosystems. If you look at surveys of what's out in the market, we survey our own clients. So I think our 1,000 clients is a reasonable proxy for what big investors are doing, large dollar investors, anywhere from tens of millions to billions of dollars. That 15%, I think there's a huge gap, and there's a lot more to come in the impact investing space. If you survey institutions and say, what are your interests, what are your focus, what are you thinking about, at the institutional level, if you just look at foundations, you see about 35 to 40%, depending on the survey you look at, express a strong interest in this. They're dedicating resources and time, which is really important at this point, because it's still an evolving field. There's a lot to learn, a lot of information coming out. But you see people are gearing themselves toward doing more aligned or impactful investing. So we're going to go somewhere from that 15 to 35 to 40, I think, over the coming decade plus, you know, give or take a few years, as we see what institutions are doing. You also have to think about what are the opportunities. So, you know, talking with Kef, like there's some scars and some hard-won lessons that all of us have from early days of impact investing, because to be successful investors, you do have to be successful more than half the time. and, you know, as an advisor and work with your clients, if you bring them bad investments, they won't do more of them. So as we think about impact investing and how we put capital to work, we want to make sure we're successful. But we look at the opportunity set. Over the 10 years that I've been at Cambridge, we have a proprietary database of which we track investment funds similar to what Ron will tell you about what he does. That has more than quadrupled to being over 1,000 investment strategies that are of institutional quality, which we'd say, and have intent for impact. So that's quadrupled in 10 years. Both the quantity and the quality of those have increased. We see a lot of big market players coming in and dedicating more time, resources, and capital to that, and also a lot of creative people coming out of the more of the social entrepreneurship side, developing ideas and businesses and making them investable. I'd say it's important to keep in mind investor consideration. So if we just look at foundations as a proxy, they need to make 5% plus inflation on an annualized basis. So there's a financial requirement they're looking for. They'd also like to do it with reasonable, or i.e. moderate volatility. And we're in a time where global interest rates are extremely low, so i.e. fixed income or bonds are expensive, and global equities have had a tremendous bull market coming out of the Great Financial Crisis, so they're expensive as well. And it could be very difficult to make that 5% at a reasonable level of volatility. So it's not an easy challenge. I think that impact investing offers a great opportunity to find some creative and interesting deals and get strong returns with reasonable volatility. So how we think about that is working with clients, we talk with them about what are your objectives, what's your financial objective, but really have a conversation about what's your purpose, your priorities, and your principles. So if you're an institution, it's thinking more broadly than just as if the portfolio lives in isolation. What is your purpose as an institution? What are you trying to accomplish from a mission standpoint? And think about all the tools you have to accomplish that. And how might portfolio investments on the financial side or philanthropic investments work more in concert? And what we've seen historically with big foundations, for example, is they often live in different silos. I'm sure many of you have seen announcements recently, say, from the Ford Foundation, where they're going to commit $1 billion of their endowment, which is about $12 billion, to impact investing. Big moves like that are starting to break down those silos, and big money like that forces these conversations to be more integrated. But in short, if you can get your purpose, your priorities, which can be mapped to investments, and your principles right, you can map that to investment strategy. And I'll give you a few examples and then cede my time so we can keep moving on this. But we look at, if I think of the impact world, I don't start with, well, what are the investable opportunities, but what are the big problems? So we divide the world into environmental sustainability or resource efficiency and social progress. And obviously there's interaction between those two things. But for example, if you subdivide it, social progress, for example, some themes that we look at would be social justice, education, health and wellness, civic practices. Not all of those will have investable opportunities from a financial side, but they give you a framing for saying, will philanthropic dollars work here? Will investment dollars work here? More specific to this panel, on the environmental side, we look at energy systems, food systems, built environment and waste, and water. And then we think, what are the big problems there? So I need to understand what those problems are, and my clients need to understand what they are and how they can best solve them, so that when I talk to someone like Ron, who I'm going to turn it over to in 30 seconds here, we can understand how someone like Ron might fit into that mosaic and the portfolio. So I guess what I tell you, in the spirit of Earth optimism, I'm very optimistic about what's happening with impact investing, about the trend lines. I think the need of it is more important than ever. I do think that it is not easy. It's going to be difficult. We have to get that 5% return for my clients, and we have to make good investments, and we can't make big mistakes because there's a lot of skeptics out there. There's a lot of people looking to tear down the efforts, and there's a lot of things we've gone into optimistically perhaps in the past and learned some lessons. But I think it'll be a great discussion and look forward to the questions that come.